on the National on Wednesday. Welcome into On the Fly. I'm Alexa Landestoy. Mike Kelly will join me shortly. We begin our look around the league in Edmonton. It's a potential preview of what we may see in the first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs. Clinching scenarios on the line for Vegas. They would love to avenge their last two blown lead losses. Now for the Edmonton Oilers. Well, hockey fans, we're going to have to wait to see Connor McDavid's quest to become just the fourth different player ever to reach 100 assists in a season, as he was listed as a game time decision and not in the lineup following a lower body injury on Saturday. Now, without further ado, let's roll those highlights.
And inside Rogers Place, sold out as per usual for a Pacific Division rematch slash playoff preview, maybe. Kicked off the Dashers to CeCe. Redirected off of Martinez. And the Oilers catch a bounce early and take a 1-0 lead. That goal will be credited to Cody CeCe, his fourth.
The Oilers strike first. Here's Dreisaitl.
Beautiful save there by Hill. Beautiful play by Dreisaitl, and Hyman slid out to Hanifin, and he mishandled the puck. And Connor Brown's away, driving in, shooting, and a save made by Hill. Rebound, chopped wide.
And gets a good shot away, and then a big rebound. But in the process, Hanifin just steamrolls right through his own goaltender. You can see him blow a wheel, can't get up. Sorry, partner, I'm going to try and go over you if I can.
Out to Corey Perry. David missed games earlier this year, two of them.
Drove one upstairs, pounding it underneath the bar for his 11th goal of the year. He matches a career high with .44. 2-0 Edmonton.
Absolute dart.
And here's another dart for Zach Hyman. Off a shot in front, Hyman cleans up the loose change for 53. And it's 3-0 Edmonton.
And now Mantha will get another opportunity on Skinner. Rishak denied.
Skinner eats it up.
Pretty veteran team here that understands situations in game and why Edmonton has to continue to keep that pedal to the metal.
Theodore pops out of the box, turnover to Quick Chance, and Hill able to be squared up against Nugent Hopkins to deny a potential dagger.
Threads it through three Vegas Golden Knights to Nugent Hopkins.
Here's another penalty. Eichel hauled down Bouchard. They put it right into the feet of White Cloud, and now you've got a two-man advantage for a full minute 15.
Yeah, he knew it right away, Eichel.
Nugent Hopkins, side of the net, Hyman. Nugent Hopkins,
one-timer, Dreisaitl scores. 4-0. Dreisaitl's 41st and his 21st on the power play.
Back to Nugent Hopkins. He quickly finds Leon Dreisaitl for that one-timer.
Hanifin looks for the home run, and has Kolesar.
Shorthanded, he scores.
And Vegas may not be done yet. Kolesar with a shorthanded goal in an effort to completely change the complexion of this one.
Here's a wraparound. Holloway scores. He'll turn it over. And Dylan Holloway makes it 5-1 Edmonton.
Great goal for the kid.
For a club that's been the best team in the NHL since American Thanksgiving. Edmonton cruises 5-1.
Vegas had a small window to get back in this game. They weren't able to cash in, and then the Oilers took advantage from there.
Well, the fans on their feet as the Oilers just keep on rolling at home with the big win over the Golden Knights. The Oilers improved to 10-0-1 in their last 11 games at Rogers Place. And during this stretch, Edmonton is averaging almost 5 goals per game, and both the power play and penalty kill have been stellar. Time now to welcome in Mike Kelly to break down all of Wednesday's action. And Mike, no McDavid, no problem for the Oilers. 5 goals, 5 different goal scorers, Matthias Ekholm being one of them. How great has he been lately?
He has been outstanding for the Edmonton Oilers. And, you know, I go back to when they made this trade to get Matthias Ekholm, and a lot of the focus, you know, rightfully so, was on his defensive ability and different ways he was going to help Edmonton that way. He's got more offensive upside, I think, than people maybe realized. And he comes to a place like Edmonton where they've got a ton of offensive skill. What he's done in terms of goal scoring, I mean, has been lights out recently in the last month, especially. In the last month, he's top 10 in the league in even strength points. Not among defensemen, top 10 overall. He's been outstanding. What he has done for Evan Bouchard, his defense partner, has been outstanding. And this is where he ranks in even strength points in the last month among defensemen. He is blowing everybody else out of the water. In 14 games, he's got as many as Connor McDavid, as many as Nathan MacKinnon. This is Matias Ekholm we're talking about. So he's been a big boost for the Edmonton Oilers and a big reason why they're rolling right now. But again, the presence that he's had in helping Evan Bouchard get his game to where it is, I think that ripple effect is also massively valuable.
Wow, you put it that way, and it really puts it in perspective. Also, a new career high with 11 goals for Ekholm. And meanwhile, as we take a look at the other side of things, it has been a very tough road trip for the Vegas Golden Knights. What's your concern level with the reigning Stanley Cup champs?
It's getting higher by the day. Like you mentioned, no Connor McDavid in this game, right? And for Vegas, they don't have Alex Petrangelo or Chandler Stephenson. Obviously, Mark Stone still not there. It's not their complete team, but you know, they made this game easy for the Edmonton Oilers in too many ways. And a lot of turnovers, a lot of extended cycle shifts. The McLeod line especially just hemming Vegas in its own end. Then Vegas will have a chance to clear a puck. They can't do it. And it just leads to more and more scoring opportunities for a very dangerous Edmonton Oilers team. 11 scoring chances in this game off of turnovers. That is way too many to be giving a good team. And, you know, Vegas has a decent record since the deadline, but they've, you know, beat up on a lot of non-playoff teams as well. Everybody seems to just be waiting for this team to flip the switch, whether that's going to happen later this week, next week, game one of the playoffs. Oh, don't worry, it's Vegas. They'll flip the switch. That's a dangerous game to play going into the postseason. And even Keegan Kolesar after the game said, you know, even if we get in, we might get bounced if we play like this. And I tell you what, if the Vegas Golden Knights play like they did in this game, they're not going to last against anybody in the postseason.
Yeah, flip the switch. Also, what have you seen from Aiden Hill and Nett? That's something that was so good a season ago. They got to have it now, especially this time of year.
Great point. And, you know, that's the one thing about Vegas. They're still not giving up a ton of quality. And that's a good thing. They're not generating as much, obviously, in this game against Edmonton as they would like. But Aiden Hill hasn't played in, you know, almost 3 weeks. He didn't look great in this game. He got run into a couple times, once by Noah Hanifin, once by Warren Fogle. You know, rebounds popping out, obviously a couple of turnovers that from him that led directly to goals. Again, not going to judge too much based on his first game back, but at the same time, his stretch of play leading up to him missing some time wasn't great. After a brilliant start to the season, I like what you said, though. For the Vegas Golden Knights, the way they're going, to have a chance if they get into the playoffs, he's going to have to be the rock star that he was last spring.
Yeah, we know the road trip wasn't good for them, but maybe getting back to the fortress is exactly what they need. Last four games of the regular season, all back at home in Vegas. So hopefully the light can flip then, because it's definitely that time of year to do so. Well, still to come right here on the Fly, the Oilers' big win on home ice kept the heat on Vancouver. We'll check in on the late game with the Canucks hosting the Yotes. Plus, Vegas' loss keeps the door cracked open for St. Louis' playoff hopes. The Blues faced a must-win game on home ice against Chicago. Stick around. Welcome back to On the Fly. We're headed now to Vancouver for the Yotes and the Canucks.
The good news, Elias Lindholm is back. He hasn't played since March of 23rd.
Coyotes right now, they need some offense in a big way.
And they score, and it's Josh Brown. Goes up top of the Coyotes with a 1-0 lead in the second.
Holy, you knew this was going to happen.
Miller with another faceoff. And Canucks have won 23 of 28. The shot attempt, who's puck, they score. Miller on the backhand. J.T. Miller with point number 101. He extends his point streak to 9 games. And the Canucks have pulled even at one.
And now back out high. Kolejachonok. They score! And it's a 2-1 game.
Kolejachonok is going to go down the line. It might be his goal.
Oxygen tank out there, Quinn Hughes.
To the front, they score, and it's Dylan Gunther, and what a play by Logan Cooley. And that's against Quinn Hughes, and it's 3-1 Coyotes.
The Coyotes are going to go back to the power play.
Joshua brings it back shorthanded, flips it across, oh, and a sliding save, Ingram, Lindholm.
What a beautiful pass to get that puck over to him. But again, Connor Ingram, this puck is looking like a beach ball to him.
Hughes gets the puck on the far side. Behind that home runner, here's Garland, he scores! Connor Garland continues to wield the hot stick. He roofed that one past Ingram, and the Canucks are back within one.
The Canucks are going to go to the power play.
Kerfoot out to greet him. Pettersson takes the pass, curls to the middle, shoots, he scores! This game is going to go to overtime. Bocelli. Lindholm continues to fight for it. Just kicked in. And stolen by Verona. Short hit off to Pauly's. He was pulled down by Schmaltz. And Philip Verona can overtime. He's going to get a penalty shot to try to win it.
They call timeout so he can catch a breather. I think they did. And he expended a lot of energy drawing that penalty shot.
Verona picks it up and it comes in on Connor Ingram. And he stopped. Oh, like a book. Connor Ingram. Dursey's got it. Gunther, side of the net. They score! Logan Cooley! And the Coyotes have won it.
Well, there you go. You called it. How about this play? Dylan Gunther, a four-point night on his birthday. How you doing? Let's go out and celebrate.
From one side to the other, how about Logan Cooley recording the first overtime game winner of his career and now has a total of 19 tallies on the season. Cooley owns the fourth most goals among rookies this season, just three behind Connor Bedard for the lead. And Mike Cooley gets the game winner, but we've got to talk about another young Yote, Dylan Gunther, getting the huge night on his 21st birthday.
Yeah, happy birthday, kid. That's a great night for him. And look, it was a bit of a tough day news-wise for Coyotes fans, and what a good way to end it, though. This was an exciting game. The overtime, the crazy penalty shot, and a lot of the young talent on this team really shining through for the Arizona Coyotes. Cooley and Gunther with great chemistry, and those guys were playing off each other so well in this game. And as you mentioned, four-point night for Dylan Gunther, who was all over it. He's got such a good shot. He knows how to get to the front of the net. Those areas where you have to go to score goals. He will be a 30-goal scorer in this league before long. Draws a penalty in overtime, and even though the overtime goal wasn't a power play goal, it had just expired, so it's effectively still a 4-on-3. That was a huge part of this play being able to happen, where Gunther, beautiful pass to Cooley for the game-winning goal. So four-point night, first of his career on his 21st birthday. Yotes get the win. And, you know, again, the fans have something excited about before they hit the sack tonight.
Yeah, points in 10 of 13 as well. So a great night for the birthday boy indeed. And how about quickly Quinn Hughes leading the charge for the Canucks? Three apples for him as well.
It's crazy what he does. I mean, he had the turnover and Cooley gets in on the forecheck against him. He comes back and puts up three assists. There's only three defensemen with 9 three-assist games in a single season. That's incredible.
Impressive list to be a part of. There are fast starts, and then there's what the Blues did on Wednesday. St. Louis scored on their first 4 shots against the Blackhawks. Goalies, close your eyes. Highlights are next. Welcome back to On the Fly. The Blues have made a strong push for the playoffs. Can they keep those hopes alive against Chicago? Let's get you out to St. Louis.
Drawn by Hofer, now ahead. Kyrou, breakaway into Claire. Shoots, he scores! Kyrou on a breakaway, and the Blues with a 1-0 lead.
Well, you want to talk about quick transition, getting pucks up the ice in a hurry. That's what it looks like right there as Jordan Kyrou gets the Blues on the board.
And Saad and Kyrou, 2-on-1. Kyrou again, and again he scores! Kyrou, and it's 2-0 St. Louis.
Nothing like 2 for the price of 1. Jordan Kyrou, 2 goals in 1 shift for the second time in a row. Goes to the blocker side of Mrazek.
Slides it across to Torrey Krug. And a goal for St. Louis from the blue line.
They score their 3rd goal before the 5-minute mark even hits. The 3rd goal in a row to the blocker side on Mrazek. Peter Mrazek has certainly had better days. Coach Luke Richardson's going to make a goaltender change.
Now Shen gets it. In front, pass across. Boldu shoots, he scores! What passing! And it's 4-0.
Boldu left all by himself back door. He puts that home. Great offensive awareness there by Zach Boldu.
Kurashev. Kurashev, Korchinski misses the net. Kurashev wraparound score! Hawks make it work, and it's 4-1.
That first one looked like it was in, and Kurashev plays it right over there to Korchinski. He misses, and here's the jam play right there.
Bedard out wide, cut off by Tucker, and a big hit on Bedard.
Yeah, and here comes Vlasic coming in there on Tucker to defend Connor Bedard. Bedard was trying to get the puck in. Good on Vlasic to come in there.
And now Bolduc back to Thomas. Kashan wide open. Rebound. They score! Thomas gets the rebound and buries it, and it's 5-1 Blues.
Great offensive sequence there by Robert Thomas.
Across to Landon Slagger. He scores!
Landon Slagart's first goal in the NHL.
And that's going to do it as the Blues win 5-2.
Well, the Blues continued their dominance over the Blackhawks with yet another win over their Central Division foes on Wednesday. St. Louis is now 8-2-0 in their last 10 games against Chicago. And in that span, the Blues have outscored the Hawks 42-24 and own a power play operating at over 20%. Now, the Blues gained some crucial ground in the Western Conference wildcard race thanks to their win and the Vegas Golden Knights' loss on Wednesday. St. Louis now sits just 3 points back of Vegas for the second and last wildcard spot in the West with only 3 games remaining in the regular season. Buckle up, this thing is getting interesting. Time now for the top shelf plays of the night.
Now Shen gets it. In front, pass across. Bolduc shoots, he scores! What passing, and Bolduc has scored again, and it's 4-0.
Beautiful passing play. Bolduc left all by himself back door.
Ryan Donato across to Landon Slagart. He scores! They will take that one off the board. Landon Slagart's first goal in the NHL.
Just a perfectly executed shot, so congratulations.
A really good guy and a heck of a defenseman.
3-0 Edmonton, number 53 for Zach Hyman.
He is now tied for second.
Side of the net, Hyman. Nugent-Hopkins.
One-timer, Draisaitl scores. 4-0. Draisaitl's 41st and his 21st on the power play.
He had no chance in that one-timer by Draisaitl.
Well, it's hard to believe, but we are in the single digits of games left in the regular season, and the race that is still far from over is the race for those last few spots in the East. Teams battling for third in the Metro and that second wild card spot. Now, many of those teams are in action on Thursday, so we're looking ahead to the slate. It's the Capitals and Sabres, Flyers, Rangers, Red Wings, Penguins, and Canadiens, Islanders. Now, Mike, no game bigger than that matchup in Pittsburgh.
Yeah, that's going to be a huge one and massive playoff implications. Pittsburgh Penguins, they're kind of buzzing lately. And what I really like about Pittsburgh is they've just simplified what they're trying to do offensively, and it's working for them. This is a team that had underperformed so much in terms of what they generated. And now they're actually seeing some results with some goals. You look at the playoff odds going in to this very interesting day. This is a game I think Detroit, they need to win it in regulation to have a real shot. Their only way in is that wild card spot. Pittsburgh can get in through wild card or Metropolitan Division, so they've got better odds, just over 40%. So this is a really, really huge game. And I am fascinated to see just if the Pittsburgh Penguins can continue to do what they've been doing lately, which is funnel pucks to the net, get deflections, get rebound screens, all those kind of things, and kind of grind the Detroit Red Wings down the way that they've been able to do against some other teams lately.
Yeah, you take a look at the upcoming schedules. Fun here. The Penguins see the Islanders on the last game of the season. That could have playoff implications. And as you just talked about, huge head-to-head matchup as Detroit fell short to the Capitals earlier this week. So they definitely want to take down the Pens if they want to stay in the race. Well, another team that has been in the race, and they have been red hot, putting together some wins, now in that third spot in the Metro, that is the Islanders. They see the Rangers and Penguins in two of their last 4 games. How can they close this thing out here down the stretch?
Yeah, the Isles have been really, really good, obviously winning 5 games in a row. They haven't lost a game yet in April, so April Fool's on everyone else that they're playing because this team just keeps winning hockey games. And the thing that jumps out the most for me, Alexa, you look at that goals against per game. Oftentimes, this is somewhat team defense, somewhat goaltending. This, to me, has been really largely goaltending in this 5-game stretch. Semyon Varlamov has come in, helped ease the burden a little bit on Sorokin. Sorokin's played well, too, but Varlamov especially has been fantastic. That difference there from 3.9 to 1.6, yeah, it's going to turn your season around for you. So hats off to the goaltending duo in New York and for Patrick Waugh as well for finding a really nice balance with those two guys.
Well, yeah, as we just talked about a few moments ago, a huge matchup for Pittsburgh, but also it was a huge matchup for the Capitals and Red Wings earlier. Charlie Lindgren stole that game. I saw all the analytics numbers you were posting. He's been stealing them for the Capitals lately.
Yes, he has. Steals a good word. It's actually a statistic that we track over at SportLogic. How often we assign a steal to a goalie. Basically, you won your team the game. And the last one that Lindgren played, that 39-save brilliant performance, that counted as a steal. It was his seventh of the season. He's top five in the NHL in that area. And you know, Alexa, from watching his team every game, that yeah, he's stolen a lot of games for them this year. So Lindgren has been such a pleasant surprise, such a difference maker for the Washington Capitals. That's a big reason why they're still right in the thick of this thing and potentially going to be a playoff team this season. And there's another team that's kind of fallen its way out of this race, and that's the Philadelphia Flyers. And they've had the opposite effect going lately. You feel bad for Arison. He's played so much and played quite well for a while. But their goaltending has absolutely gone in the tank in the last, you know, 3 weeks especially. And that's a big reason why, you know, this team that 3 weeks ago, they were neck and neck with the Capitals. And we didn't know who was going to make it if it was only going to be one of those teams. Now they're kind of hanging on life support here. They got about a 5% chance of making the playoffs. And there's a lot of reasons why team fatigue in general. It's a young team. John Tortorella's talked a lot about this. And there's no real one thing, but by far the biggest thing is goaltending. This is the last 3 weeks. This is goals saved above expected. And at minus 20.2, nobody is even close to the Philadelphia Flyers.
Well, it's crazy. You talk about odds. At one point, everyone had written off the Pittsburgh Penguins, written off the Washington Capitals. Yep. Here they are in the fight. At one point, it was the Philadelphia Flyers were ahead of schedule for their franchise in the hunt for the playoffs. I think Tortorella pulled out everything in the book to get his team here down the stretch. You mentioned youth fatigue maybe a little bit as you see these numbers drastically going down, but still a bright future for a very young franchise.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what I don't think we can lose in all of this is that if you told Flyers fans that, hey, in April, this team is in the mix, right? And they were until a couple days ago, I think. And now it's kind of fallen off. But if you told Flyers fans that, they say, wow, what happened this season? How did this all work out this way? And it is about the future. That's the one thing I do like about this Flyers organization. It doesn't look like they've taken their eye off the prize, which is not do anything you can to get in this year. It's let's build a foundation so we can get in every year with a lot of really good young players. Still a really bright future.
Yeah. Well, Mike, this has been fun. Get our popcorn ready because this thing is coming down to the wire on both sides of thing. It's been fun.
It's been a blast to watch. And your Capitals, I'm telling you, with that kind of goaltending, they got a good shot.
Ovi, the power play, things are heating up in Washington as this thing is coming down to the wire. Just a few games here left in the regular season. Well, for Mike Kelly, I'm Alexa Landestoy, and from our entire crew here at NHL Network, thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next time.